I've known Ardhendhu for now more than 30 years, you know. I remember when Masanobu Fukuoka came to India for the first time in 1988, and he was awarded in Shantiniketan the Deshikottam Award by the Prime Minister of India. Ardhendhu was there translating from Japanese to English. His wife is Japanese, and he spent a fair amount of time in Japan, so he knows quite a few languages actually well. And yeah, when Fukuoka also came to our bookstore when we had just started, Ardhendhu was again there translating. Then he did learn organic agriculture. He was working for a while with the village action group in Oroville with the local people, passing on knowledge of organic and ecological agriculture. He set up an organization called Service Center, the larger form of which is DRCSC, Development Research Communication and Services Center. Again, you know, almost a quarter century ago, and it's perhaps one of the very few organizations doing very good work in training in ecological agriculture in West Bengal. And West Bengal has a predominance of small land holdings, you know. So the kind of training module which Ardhendhu has developed is specifically targeted also to self-reliance in small holding, combining various elements. And there are many parts of Bengal nearby under wetlands. So it's a combination of systems, you know, with fish, water, aquatic rice, and yeah. I don't want to get into too much more of those details. I think it's a good enough introduction for now, and I'll ask Ardhendhu to take over.
I am not an agriculture student in university. I studied accounting and economics, so. But I got involved in the rural areas as a volunteer for doing educational work among the children, and then later on among the adult. And because most of them were involved in agriculture, so the books or educational material that I was trying to create for them for adult education was about agriculture, and that is how I learned. So more than teaching, in the beginning most of the time I was, the strength of my trainer as now is because I learn agriculture more for people than from textbook. Later on I have picked up textbook, I have done some farmer courses also, but that is later. So that is brief background. The term wetland, we have to be a little clear. Of course, in dry area also there is wetland. In dry area there can be lowland and can be irrigated and can be rice growing. So it is not strictly only about wetland. It is a little bit, and permaculture is a design principle that can be applied to lowland, that can be applied to upland, that can be applied to any land. The main three, not very strict scientific definition, but the three basic zones in India, we can say the areas where there is never water. So they are very dry area, like desert area, arid area, Rajasthan, Gujarat, some areas, Maharashtra, some areas. So can be very arid. So that needs a different approach almost, because the crops have very different kind of crops and trees can grow there. The rest of India, anyway, is a dry and wet mix. It is either, even those some areas in West Bengal have lot of rain, but only within 4 months. Only within 4-5 months, 90% of the rain happens. As a result, these are called semi-arid areas. in India, the zone where part of the time it is wet, but the ponds dry up during the dry season, which is now, January, February, March, April, May. After June, the rain starts. So that means in those areas, in the design, how you can store the rainwater and use that in the later period, that becomes very important. What we are referring to as wetland here means, number one, sometime it is flooded, sometime it is near the coast. Because of that, it is flooded with saline water also. And we are speaking about high rainfall areas where ponds don't dry up. This is the important thing, that the ponds more or less remain, small ponds also hold water around the year. So this is the first important consideration. But many of the techniques and technologies and principles we are going to show here, they can be applied as much to dry land. Only the choice of species and other thing will be a little bit different. Otherwise, it is very similar. The other important consideration, therefore, about submerged lands or waterlogging or cyclone problem will be there in coastal areas, where I am going to show most of work. And secondly, the soil often is very clay. In dry areas, often it is very eroded and pebble. But here, there is soil, but the soil gets waterlogged, especially during the rainy season. When the too much rain is happening, the drainage, the absorption of the water is very slow. This is the problem that we have to deal with. We don't have our own demonstration farm or anything. We work in farmer's land, and suppose a person have 1 acre land, which is already big in West Bengal, because 1 acre, 2 acre farms are more than 50% of the situation. So in quarter part of that or fifth part of that, we do our demonstration. We try to show how, what to do. Slow, we don't change everything at the same time. We slowly keep the farmer, because the farmer has to eat and not prove a point, not prove any theory. So he has to eat. Therefore, it is important that suddenly we don't increase the risk. The main question they are looking for is how to reduce the risk. So how we can change step by step using principles, this is, we are showing the work, and then later on we'll have question answer and discussion and other thing. Okay, so in the morning we are listening to this question of food security. I will only add that food security does not mean only security of eating. It means eating food, eating nutritious food, and to have nutritious food, it is important to have proper water. Otherwise, anyway, food will not be possible to cook or digest. And also, fuelwood, some kind of fuel, because without that, food is not also available. So, food security means access to food, access to water, access to some kind of energy. This is important. Later on, we'll see why. So when we do permaculture, we are not talking only about how to produce more. We are talking about how to produce more food. We are talking about how to have more water. We are also talking of how to manage our energy situation. And secondly, we are also talking about livelihood security, because people, agriculture, apart from producing food, produces a lot of byproduct or waste material, and in processing that, people generate a lot of jobs. Whether they make a mat, whether they make a rope, whether they make. So there are agriculture, animal husbandry based livelihood, and there are also non timber forest product based livelihood. So some of that also will be here. you will see that. So the whole idea of permaculture is, number one, start with the mapping the situation, understanding the situation, and be sure what is your goal, where you want to go. So what is the present situation of food, fodder, fuel, etc., and what will be the situation 5 years or 10 years later, and towards that slowly help people to change. So to bring about change is the major part, and so this is the interventions to build ecological farms. These are all small farmers, and how to do home garden. So home garden, farms, forest, food forest, these are small ecological regions. In permaculture we call zone 0, zone 1. Zone 0 is inside the house, zone 1, zone 2, zone 3, like that. So we'll see all of that. But because of time, we'll focus mainly on 2 zones. The other zones, if you have question, you can ask. Next. So as you see here, the women and other villagers, children sometimes adults, male. So they are drawing a map of their own village on the land, showing in different colors what is the land use. So this is very important, whether you do individual permaculture or whether you do community permaculture, it is important to make a map of the existing land use and try to understand how people see themselves, what is the problem. Before we suggest solutions, we need to understand how much resource people have and how they are using it. So this is one such we call participatory mapping. There are many layers, but just I am showing one or two. Yeah. The same question, that learning about needs, resources, food and livelihood security. That means how many months they have food problem, how many months they have water problem, to map that. So it is not all around the year. Maybe scarcity is during some period. So how long and for how many people? This is important to understand if you are going to work with a community. Same thing. So using color, so they are showing also the different kind of land and what they are doing, where they are growing rice, where it is dry, where it is upland, where it is little bit water and other thing. So these main are the goals of the permaculture, the diversifying crop, integration of perennial plants, trees, bush, whatever it is, small animals. So it is a combination of crops, seasonal crops, annual crops, trees and animals. So this integration is very important for the cycle to move and to make sure one waste is feeding other and there is a good proportion of this. So that is what I am saying, that if we have to raise productivity and reduce the risk, it is better not to focus only on crop, only on tree, only on animals like that, but a combination of that, and that helps. Next. So these are the some of the small, we can say zone 1, zone 2. I am using common simple language like home gardens, small farms, wetlands and rivers, mangroves. So how do we apply permaculture to these ecozones? That is explained in the, I will be explaining these two. Then these I am not going to cover. If you have question, you can ask me. And so change are possible in each ecosystem. So ecosystem is a distinct combination, a place where we, purpose is somewhat different. Maybe here the purpose is mainly to produce nutritious food for the family. Maybe here the purpose is to generate food, also generate some income. Maybe here the people catch fish during the rainy season.
So the purpose is different and the resource is also different. What kind of resource they have, how many months they have water in the river. So accordingly, so when you work with any area, try to look at the land, how people use it, from where the inputs come and to whom the output goes. Is it basically for subsistence? Is it basically also for income? Is it important for... These are obvious, but better to state the obvious. Next. So, home garden is the first. So, home gardens are agroforestry systems because they have agriculture and they have tree. And the focus should be on year-round availability of nutritious food, whether in dry area, whether in wet area. So, the important question is that home garden is very different from a farm. Sometimes we don't recognize that, but home garden is basically because you focus on nutritious food. Sometimes a food may not have any commercial value, but it may be very useful as a nutritious. There are many nutritious weeds also, which can, if people have say that sometime I have no time to do gardening, does not matter. If there is any weed which can grow by itself, grow it, provided it is edible, nutritious, tasty. Therefore, some of the commercial crops which are very important in the market are not present in a nutrition garden. For example, I see that confusion among even many of my friends who are doing advanced permaculture or ecological agriculture. For example, cauliflower, for example, cabbage. These may be, you may like to eat them and they may be fetching you more money in the market, but because you cannot produce the seed, therefore, it should not be part of your home garden. I'm not saying you should not be growing it. You may, whether you depend on Indian multinational or foreign multinational for seed, that is your choice, but basically they are hand in hand with each other. So if you want farmer control, this is a political question on the farming, it is very important that they control the seed. Anyway, so growing diverse kind of thing, and because it is a small area, trying to use vertical spaces, all spaces, this is very important. So growing many kind of, this is amaranth, many gourd, some kinds, some lady's finger, so many kind of plants can grow. And this is important to understand, even for us as a consumer, apart from a farmer, that there are more than 30,000 plants for which more or less record is available. And of these 3,000, we have very good information available. But most of the time, we cultivate only 300, 10% of 10%. And then, most of the time, when we eat, we are eating only about 30. So we are using only 1% of 1%, something like that, of biodiversity, and then we are complaining about food scarcity. The scarcity is there because in market only certain things are sold, and they are sold, for example, cabbage, cauliflower, green peas, etc., they are grown all round the year. So if it is grown all round the year, most of the problem of pest, most of the problem of disease, most of the need of fertilizer is because of that. So as we say that when we grow wrong thing at the wrong place at the wrong time, then you need chemical inputs. And it makes more profit, that is why people grow it. So it is not true that you cannot eat. It is not true that you cannot produce enough for people on the earth or India or any place. It is possible to grow many kind of things. It is possible to grow intensively. So if you ask me the question, can you have enough food, for example, if there is a 5-person family? The mathematical simple calculation is, okay, so if every day 5 persons need about 200 grams of vegetable and maybe 250 grams including fruits, etc. So 5 persons means 1 kilo, 250 to 1.5. So in a week, maybe 10 kilos. So in a week, if we have to produce 10 kilos of vegetable with, let's say, 2-3 buckets of water, in a land which is maybe 500 square feet or something like that. So, can we do that? Is it possible to do that? That is what we are trying here to see. So, in goal for home garden is like that. So, you define your goal in terms of what quantity, what season, how long, and nutritionally what value. Not bother about the food and the market value, because there are many food which are very nutritious, which are easy to grow without water also and with some, because even in wetland there is a dry season that we have to understand. So can we grow many kind of things so that our nutritional need is met? And some of these, for some of these crops, in our agricultural training and education, there is hardly, about cabbage there will be 50 pages. About gongura, 50 words maybe. About yam, 50 pages. No need of 50 pages, only 50 lines. So there are many crops which are traditionally there. It is a crop which tolerates yam, for example, is a plant which tolerate drought and flood from about this much, 100 gram, in about 10 months, you can produce 20 or 30 kilo of food, roots. It is not attacked by any pest or insect. Sometimes wild boar is problem, sometimes rats are a problem, but it is, other than that, it has no pest or disease. And it can grow in a very little space. It climbs on a tree, so it needs very little space on the ground. And yet, and it is a important medicinal plant also. Country like Japan, country like, they import this from, because it include a chemical called Dioscorin. Dioscorin is a chemical which is used for heart medicine. So it is a potato which can actually cure heart disease rather than cause heart disease. And yet, in 5 years book that we read in agriculture, no mention of this except for the name and the thing. How to plant it, how it grows. There is a Central Tuber Crop Research Institute also. The government officials will point out, yes, that is there, but it is just there. They hardly anybody does any work, hardly any extension worker or in government distribute the seed. So you have to go to Trivandrum or you have to go to Bhubaneswar. These are the places where they have. So they do on. Next. So diversification is very important, and stacking. In permaculture we call stacking. That means using all available space. So have something below, have something in the medium, have something on top. This is a very important thing. Have a tree, fire here. Next. So again, showing that below you have a pond, small pond, which is storing the roof water. Above there is a frame where some kind of gourd is growing, sometimes basilar also in a lateral way. And then we have some shade loving plant, and then we have some tree. So home garden is always meaning a small area but intense use of all the space, not just horizontal space but vertical space also. Permaculture talks about that, that we need to stack, we need to have multi-story farming. Next. Another example of that, again, this is in a hill area in West Bengal. So this is lined with a simple in thing because of the soil absorbs some water very quickly or something, percolates. So to stop percolation, some kind of azolla is being grown. We'll talk about that, and frame is being made. Ideally, this frame itself, rather than bamboo initially, later on can become a supari or some other tree. That itself can, so even the legs of the thing can be productive. I mean, no need of bamboo. Why not make four corner pillars out of drumstick? So that when the vegetable cannot be grown during dry season, at least the leaf of the tree will be available for eating. The leaf of the drumstick tree is rich in vitamin C, vitamin A, calcium, iron. These are the main missing elements in Indian nutrition. So therefore it has all. So ideally, if you are talking about eating one handful in the morning and one handful in the evening every day with dal or with sabji or anything, just drumstick leaf, that most of your malnutrition need can be easily avoided by that. So, and yet we have so many hundreds of programs of feeding and this and that, but we are not talking about that. Every house should have 2-3 of this kind of trees, curry leaf, drumstick, etc., where we can, it is very nutritious and we can eat anytime, irrespective of whether there is water or not. So even in a dry area it can be done, and of course in wet area it is possible. This shows again the same thing. So the permaculture principle that we have to buy home grain is that we have to catch and store things like water, sunlight, nutrients, etc. So roof water harvesting is possible in a small nutrition garden. So all the roof water can be stored in a pond. This is a specific technology very suitable for wetlands where there is seasonal dry, but otherwise, yeah, so we are trying to. This is in a saline coastline area in Sundarbans. About 4-5 years ago, there was a major cyclone during which the bunds were breached in many places and seawater entered. So as a result, all the ponds have become saline. This was called Ayla cyclone. Many people died, and also people lost most of their agricultural land because they became saline, so they could not grow any more rice. So most of the male population has gone out in search of work. So only women and some children, old people are left behind in the village. So as a part of what we can do with the rehabilitation, so this is we have a tank, and this itself is a polishing sheet which is storing the rainwater. So rainwater as a source of drinking water, so having safe drinking water, as I said, is as important as having good food. Because if it is safe food but unsafe water, then food security wise it is not a very useful thing. One way to save water and do less labor intensive irrigation is to have a earthen pot buried in the soil and have small holes at 6 inches below the soil. Let it spread out so water does not evaporate, and also water goes as it is pitcher irrigation, subsoil irrigation. The more, so we can plant pumpkin or something and it will easily spread out to about 3 meters on both sides. So only you have to put water here and it will cover this entire land. So this is just the beginning, it is showing that. This technique is important even for semi-arid lands and also for wetlands in the dry season. Next. Right now. This is a specific technique for wet areas. Wet areas, one of the problem is during the rainy season there is too much water somewhere. So seedling growing and other thing becomes delayed. So people can grow things in floating nurseries, in floating rafts or something, and make water hyacinth is a weed which you may be familiar with. Water hyacinth is a weed everywhere in tropics, and it is very light, and because of its lightness it can be chopped up and mixed with some cow dung and thing and make a ball from which you can plant a seed. Even things which we don't transplant normally, like pumpkin or something, can be planted there, because later on you can transplant the whole ball, not take out the plant. So, and they can be put on a raft made of banana or bamboo or something, and no matter how much the water increases, it keeps floating. And the moment the, so you don't have to wait for 5-6 weeks before the water subsides and land is ready for transplanting. Already plant can grow, and so you can save a lot of time. Next. Another technique for very wet areas is when you take this kind of plastic bags about this big, ideally any other bag will also do, but because these are cheap cement bags sometimes or something, so you make there and you can either grow from here itself or you can get everything ready in one place, and when the field, later on you will see, you can put it in the field also. So below is flooded, but above many crops are growing. So even in a saline field, if we have a frame like this, or we put a bag here, and in the bag there are three, let's say, ridge gourd or something. So on top there is a bamboo frame with a, in a wet area there are a lot of old fishing nets available free of cost, almost. So we spread that and it grows from here onto that. So she is experimenting with this, and now we are experimenting with many things. We see that potato can be grown, sweet potato can be grown, of course most of the cucurbits can be grown, and because they need well-drained situation, they die from waterlogging. So this is one way to avoid the waterlogging. Next. So this is recycling the waste, as Narasana was saying in the morning, how to recycle the agro waste. This is important, but it should be done properly. If we, in most Indian village, people dump cow dung, just cow dung, in a place. This may be a traditional practice, but this is not a very good practice. Number one, because it takes long time to dry. Number two, to become compost. Number two, in the center, quite often it burns. Number three, it makes the soil acid. Number four, it can reintroduce many weed, because you are making a compost heap, like, it looks like compost. It should be called farmyard manure. Farmyard manure is not compost. Just like dal bhat is not khichdi. So we need to remember that it is important to mix proper ratio and also rotate, because climatologically now we know that methane is one of the very important destroyers of the creators of the global warming. So we need to make compost, but at the same time we need to try to make a compost in a way that it has more oxygen, and most of the methane which escape is either processed by a good mixture, or it is mixed in a, we make a biogas out of cow dung. Next. So this is an example of a plant, azolla. In home garden also, we did the experiment. So by putting this, why azolla is so important? Maybe you know. How many people know azolla? Okay, so I don't have to explain too much. So azolla is a aquatic weed, roughly 30% protein, crude protein, therefore it is a good fodder, and it can be produced in a very shallow water body. And the most important part is azolla can double its volume in about 5-6 days. There are very few things in on the earth which can do that. So as a result, if you have one for Monday, one for Tuesday, one for Wednesday, one for Thursday, every day, once it becomes full, every day you can take half and feed it to your cattle. And next week when you come back, it will be again full. So azolla can be grown directly in the rice field, in the wetland. We can grow here and we can take and spread there, because it is spread all over, that we see better. But it can be grown also in a small container and used either as fodder or as fertilizer, because the roots can fix nitrogen. Azolla anabena association. So whenever we are growing azolla in a field, it means it is not only controlling weeds, it is also contributing to the by nitrogen fixing. Does it give
mosquitoes?
This is not killing mosquitoes or any. Mosquito will need to breathe in a clean water, but this covers all water, so hardly any mosquitoes will be there. For mosquito control, you need to also use maybe ducks or some other mechanism. We will see that. But right now we are talking about what are some of the small technologies that can be used in a home garden. Yes.
Azolla is also edible?
No.
Is it poisonous?
Not by human beings. But by fish it is edible, by duck it is edible, by any animal, water buffalo, anything which is edible. By after drying, and it can be even fed to the chicken with other food. But normally, for those who take water, aquatic diet, for them it is good. You can maybe start a research on that. I am sure it will be possible, but there are many, many plants already that we neglect. For example, wing bean. Do you know wing bean? Wing bean, Indian wing bean is about this big, Goa wing bean, and Filipino wing bean is about this long. And
what's the name of the long one?
Filipino. Wing bean. Because it has four wings. The scientific name is too long. My remaining teeth will be gone also. But it is called Sopocarpus tetragonolobus. Yeah. But if you put in internet wing bean, you will get most of the information.
For mosquitoes, we have 21.
Why it is important? Why I am saying wing bean? Number one, because
For mosquitoes, we have 21 plants. Mosquito repellent plants like lemon grass, citronella, rosemary, lavender. Those will repel the mosquitoes.
We'll come to that. We'll come to that.
And tribals creep on tree.
No, we are talking just now because he are talking about what is edible.
Okay.
So I was referring that wing bean, there are, as I was saying, that for plants for home garden should be specially rich in nutrients. So wing bean is one such plant which is easily grown from seed, which you can eat the leaf, eat the flower, eat the fruit, even eat the root, But don't eat it while it is alive, otherwise but it can, you can do. And once you plant it, from the root, second year, third year, normally it will sprout again. Wing bean is equal in protein to soybean. So almost 30% is protein. The only problem is that wing bean can become stringy when a little bit mature and dry seed is not available. And so, and maybe middleman it is not so interesting. So in India, most of the people who are sitting here, I don't think have eaten a wing bean.
We have.
How many? Good. Already 1/3 almost have eaten here in this room. But this is a very special type of people.
Thanks to Deepika of Federal Gardens, she promotes it and we all got seeds.
And I gave the seed to Deepika.
Oh.
Yeah. She is a good friend and I think she today is going to speak sometime. Yeah, Deepika has been instrumental in spreading that in, I was in Oroville earlier for 5 years, so we exchange seed even now, and last, about 2 months ago, just before the flood, I visited their farm. Yeah.
So, can azolla also be used in composition with water hyacinth?
Somewhat difficult, but why compete with water hyacinth? Why not see it as a God's gift to you and harvest it and chop it to make compost or make...
Actually, my next question is going to be, will it help filter water by any chance, azolla?
Not much. It removes some phosphate,
okay.
So if it is a detergent-loaded water, it can maybe help. But it is basically grown in a very small depth area, because if it is grown in a pond, what happens is it flourishes and then it grows too much and then it competes with each other. It is like tilapia fish. So sometimes it can grow too much, you have to remove regularly, otherwise, yeah.
This gentleman's question was about growing water hyacinth and azolla together.
If there is water hyacinth growing, basically, it is indicating, every weed is indicator.
Mm-hmm.
Water hyacinth is indicating that somehow too much nutrient is getting mixed in the water. Some cow urine or cow dung or something is growing. Because water hyacinth to flourish needs a lot of nitrogen. So that nitrogen must be coming from somewhere. And maybe it is getting wasted, maybe you should be using it. So that is how I will approach the problem.
Rather than trying to control.
The question is whether azolla can be grown where water hyacinth is.
Normally not, because water hyacinth is growing in a pond, deep pond, and azolla is growing in shallow water in rice field or something. In rice field, it will overgrow other weeds, other grasses and other things. So, but it is not a very good plant for deep water. That is what I was saying, that in a deep pond, if you give azolla, for a while it will flourish and after that it will disappear. That is why in a natural pond you don't find so much azolla. So azolla you have to grow in a shallow water and you can use a little bit of vermicompost or something just to feed it. Just one handful per one hole like this. Okay. So growing many kinds of plants together, diversity, this is the main way of reducing the risk of pest, weed and disease. Yeah, next. Chicken and goat, they are very important. Chicken, goat, duck, etc. Because, and you can put them in a house, small house, on the water, so that they climb and you close. So, the duck dropping or chicken dropping or rabbit dropping falls right in the pond and becomes feed for fish. So any such good design for ideas that we can feed, one feed the other, so it becomes fish food or become duck food and you don't have to clean. But the important question is, in all integrated systems, so you have to calculate how much is the pond surface area and water volume,
and how many parts you can keep, because it is same like salt in your food. It is necessary, it is good, but not good if it is too much. It becomes makes the food inedible. So in the same way, if there are too many ducks and their shit is dropping, instead of becoming fish food, it may actually create oxygen deficiency and fish are dying. It's a simple idea to integrate. So for small farmers, they don't have a large poultry and cage and other thing. This is just a fishing net. And so they try. So all small farmers are keeping some mudfish, or it is not the normal kind of fish we are eating in the market nowadays. Money, it is not carps. Carps need a little more depth of water. If you have shallow water, use the insect eating fish. They are actually prescribed by doctors nowadays because they have less fat. And they are almost as expensive in the market as catfish and those kind of species which have no scale. The insect eating carnivorous fish, they are useful for rice fields and for small ponds and home gardens also. Now, this is going a little bit beyond, but to remind that what I was saying earlier, that if you have a lot of animal waste, sometimes government has subsidies. We have to give a little encouragement and do it properly to make a biogas, because apart from the whole idea of gardening and home gardening and all things is to improve health. If the person cooking is using a very smoking chulla and always becoming sick and always breathing too much carbon dioxide and dust, which is not so good for health. So while improving zone 1, think also about improving zone 0. So how to filter the water, how to make workload less for the women, how to make it more healthy for crops. Sometimes you can make a frame up on the water, and even during the flooded time, even from sack, the goats which are growing can grow over the water. So you can have fish here, and you can have this here, and you can use this for irrigation also. So again, a simple idea. But a projected thing over the water, that space can also be used, provided it is not more than 5-6 feet into the water, and provided it is about 6 feet above the water surface. These are important things. Because if the light is blocked, then the fish in the pond will suffer. So you have to make, if this is a pond, you are making this, you are making bamboo here, so it remains a little higher, and so here, and otherwise that area will not be utilized by fish, that food. So this is widely practiced in Bangladesh and nothing anyway, but it is just a little bit adjustment of making. Yeah, next. So here is a rice field, but we make a canal here, and over the canal again some creepers, and below the canal some ducks are working and fish is here. So rice, fish, mudfish, duck, some banana trees, some perennials and some creeping, all this can be combined together. That is the whole idea of that in permaculture, each of the thing like a small farm level. So now we are moving to from home garden to a small farm level. Diversification and integration. So diversify, have 10 kind of at least crop growing every season, and have them in a way that they are helping each other. All this is doable with very little investment, as you can see, but it needs some labor, and it is the initial investment in digging the pond or digging the trench that is there. Sometime earlier it was possible because of the NREGA funds also, so the poor people got organized and got some help from government. But nowadays, in the last 2-3 years, NREGA
support has almost gone stop. So integration rather than segregation is key to build resilient ecosystem. Not me, SNCV, the statement from Omgren, founder of Permaculture. So combination of these, this is my word. Animals, birds, aquatic organisms, plants. So try to think about that in each system, as in the morning Zuk was saying about parts which are combined together, assembled together. So in theory, if we are thinking, I think I have patent on this design. So think about trees and shrubs, perennials, think about vegetables and grains, the seasonal crops, think about aquatic plants and maybe fish, maybe duck also, think about them, think about microorganisms and edible things from insect, for example honey, for example mushroom, so think about them, that is another group. Think about animals, like whether it is a cow or goat or any such thing, and think about birds. So there are six elements, and to remind that because it is a formula for in science for CH4 and other things, so hexagon is something which is expanding infinitely. This is the highest size of polygon that can be repeated. Why these make it like this? Because when you have already two, the third, already two walls are there. So it is most economic to make like this. Neither square nor circle or not anything is possible to do convention. Anyway, that is why I chose this. But within each of these, there are three. So six into three choices are there. What are the three? Can you think? What are the three? No. There is nature. Nature means naturally growing plants which are growing. So we can eat many weeds also as a food. Culture means what we grow, agriculture. And what is this? We are all familiar with this, but we don't remember this when we do design. Not sorry, nature, anyway.
Nature, nutrition.
Nurture. What is nurture?
Natural ones that you take care of to help them be whatever.
Yeah. Nurture is something where you are, Indians have been doing, world have been doing it for a long time. Just that the Indian people have not learned from that. Almost in every village you will see that they have a small pot here for pigeon. Mm-hmm. Pigeon will come. It is not nature. 100%. It is not hunting bird. It is not 100% culture. It is a middle somewhere where there is nurture. In a rice field in the village, in the corner, you will see that people have made a hole, and in the hole they have put some leaf of pumpkin, so that when there is flooding, fish can come in, and then eating insect it becomes big. But it cannot go out because of the farmland. So this is two of many farmers who are doing. They have not done permaculture course, but they are already doing something from which we can learn and we can improve that system. And these are things which are examples of nature. That means we create the condition in which nature produces. If it comes from half from nature, some indigenous people in a hill area in West Bengal, they are catching a small bird, but they are not eating. They are keeping it in the home. And later on, they go to the area near the edge of the forest and tie the bird. I asked them, what you are doing? Why you are doing this? So he said that when we tie the bigger one, he will call. He will call and the wild bird will come and will trap that and will eat. That is why you are nurturing this bird. So sometimes this situation is there. Some many interesting things. In Cambodia, northeast Cambodia in a hill area, they were growing short bean. So I assume they are eating this nutritious thing. So I asked them, oh, this is good, you are growing this. And so he said, no, we don't eat that bean. If you don't eat, why you are growing it? So he said, we are growing it because it attracts a particular kind of beetle insect and we love to eat that beetle. So it is as a trap we are growing this stuff. So please try to understand that this idea of trapping. So out of this period, you hardly provide anything else other than living space. It collects its own food. And people who cannot afford chicken and other things, they are sometimes killing some of these birds and eating. So it is their poultry. So try to think about animals, fish, bird, which can be attracted. So trapping, combination of crop trees, combination of this, that means you have 18 kind of choices. So in trees there are nurture, there is nature, there is culture. So if there is a tree you are growing, it is culture. If it is growing in the forest, it is nature. If you are bringing from the thing and putting in a pot and some place to protect it, that is nurture. So it is possible to for animals, there are wild animals, there are domestic animals, and there are animals which are in between. So try to think about that. Can you think of animals which are in between? In Japan it is used very much in rice. In rice, ducks are used. Later on you will see the picture. Next picture you can go. Yeah. So, but the modern duck is not of much use. It is used for the government because it gives more eggs. The only problem is that duck does not want to get into deep water. Actually, the duck has been developed genetically for people like khaki gambel or other ducks. They have been developed, they give more eggs, but they don't like to eat inside, go and swim in water. They are waiting for you to feed them. So you spend more money feeding. So Japanese people, they use the wild ducks which come through and they remain in a place and during that time they mate. So it is a mixture of the wild duck and the artificial duck. So they call it Harigamo. Harigamo means a love child. Hari and this Kamo, this. So that is used in the rice field. So it is called Harigamo culture. So try to understand that there are many areas where this is possible, where wild pigs and natural Chinese pigs, they mate sometime and produce a different kind of progeny. So in your area, try to look at what are the, your resources are, but your resources, they are not everywhere. They are not, you don't have to import from India to grow in your country. But wherever you are working, you don't have to import from Telangana to the investment market. You look at what trees, what crops, what things are growing in your area. Maintaining that inventory is very important work for farmers.
If you don't know that, no matter how much permaculture you have studied, you will not be able to apply it. So, first work, start with a map and start with understanding of what are the local resources. So next, this is already used. Again, another canal. So this will be grown over the net. So we have some creeping kind of legume beans. And in between here, the fish, insect eating fish is going. So because insect eating fish is eating and the ducks are going here, they are always moving the water, not allowing the weed to come up, and they eat, control the grass, and they control the insect. So you don't have to do that hard work. Especially women are engaged in wading in rice field, and whole day, lot of work. Picking grass from rice field is not a very easy thing. So this is the difference in the mixed culture, that if you have proper ratio, how many ducks, how much water, how much rice, how much azolla, how many, this is important. But so it is a management intensive, not input intensive, but it is knowledge intensive, it is management intensive. You have to do that. And that you can do only by lab in the land, not lab to land. Not possible, because what is in lab, you are going to be participating. You cannot extend. If you take a gamla like this, I say often that in India, agriculture is gamla culture. People do PhD by studying in this kind of gamla, putting four rice, four plants each, and then predicting what you will do in 1 hectare of land or 1 acre of land.
Canals and ponds in lowland paddy fields, I explained already. Yeah, next. You will see that. So you have channel around the whole rice field in the perimeter, and ducks, and this is only a 6 feet, about 2 meter wide channel. Next. And now you see. So far the ducks are not asking for extra salary or bonus or anything. They are working free of cost for you. So don't see duck only as egg producing machine, see it also as a manure producing machine. See it also something as moving always the water, and therefore oxygenating, therefore methane emission is less, and therefore grasses cannot grow so easily. So the work of the duck needs to be appreciated. There is a book by a person, Japanese person, but it is also available in English. From the Permaculture Association. It is called One Duck Revolution by Takao Kuruma. Yeah. Next. So, ducks also provide manure, do not allow grasses and weeds to increase, and control pests. Next. So, when in the rice field, one corner, we have a pond and we have a frame over the pond to grow some trellis over the pond, grow something, you are using permaculture principles, storing water, you are also using multi-story, and from here on the back, because rice field has lot of water, so in order to grow a creeper near the corner, you can have either a hole and dig up and change the soil composition by mixing sand or rice's charcoal, and you can grow over. So it becomes, rice field is only for 4 months, but this is almost for the whole year, some production is possible.
So try to make always production more and more, even in a wetland.
So here these nets, etc., are basically for the fish not to, some place to control, they can go, and some place they cannot go.
Yeah, and why I explained about the duck, the important thing is, if you can make a duck house, of course if you have fox or dogs or something that attack the duck. Indian ducks don't get attacked by dogs so much, but in Japan it is a big problem. So they have electric fences and all other things. That is expensive, but here you can, the ducks, if they are kept near the field, their duty hour is not 10 to 5. They
have only two purpose in life, either to eat or to sleep. So they sleep, when they wake up, they work. And because they eat all the time. And by eating all the time, they can actually, you need to grow azolla in between rice so that you don't have to buy food from the market, because that is very important also, because otherwise a lot of money will go.
So in wetland, if you make it broad, you can grow beans in between rice also. That is what it is showing. This is showing the leaf, removing some rice feed to maintain a density. Yeah, next. So soil management by mulch, etc., green manuring, these are the main techniques: mulches, biofertilizers, manure teas, worm compost, green manuring. These are the main strategies. There are many others, but these are the main strategies. And you can see things can grow. This is a larger farm scale vegetable, not the home garden. Yeah, next. So again, the same idea, looking from other angle, trellises over the water and 6 feet, and as I said, pumpkin and other things are growing. Traditionally, the Indian varieties were climbing type. Nowadays they are spreading type, the hybrids are spreading type. But all the traditional varieties either climbing on roof or climbing on a machan or something. So all the lao, the bottle gourd, all the pumpkin, all the ash gourd, ridge gourd, other gourd, they can grow. So it is just one example. It can be beans also. Yeah, next. Ash and beans. Yeah, so when there is lot of flood, and in a rice field if you want to grow vegetable, either you have to do this or next. Even flooded soil, so you can see that same idea, the back plant, but blacks have been put on a mold, so below it is flooded. So you are trying to avoid the flood and avoid the, make it. So here, if it is perennial, you can put net around, and during the rainy season, you may be growing fish, crab, other aquatic organism, and duck. And when the water goes down, during that time you can grow another crop. Because in flooded areas, in wetland area, there can be many fields which are waterlogged during the whole rainy season. Except for rice, there are not many things that can grow in that environment. Next. Conserving biodiversity and associated local knowledge, which I already spoke to you, is very important. But involving women, children, especially the resource poor, as they suffer most and know best about local biodiversity. So don't use your book knowledge to select plants. It is very limited. There are many other kind of. So here, because of the time, I am not showing how we are doing this, but this is also important, how you learn from people about plants and other things. So there can be many ways, by working together with them, by making a proper chart. I will show a little bit of that. Yeah, so here children are talking about plants which grow around them and how the plants are used for making traditional medicine or something. Next. Yeah, so all the plants that they have collected, first they put on a piece like this, and they put 1, 2, 3, some number. And later on a wall, we have the same number, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And then different uses, food, fodder, other thing. And whether this is a good plant for that or not, so by doing that, slowly you understand what are the plants which are growing, which are multi-use in that community. So simple tools like that of participatory knowledge generation is very important. Is permaculture is not just agricultural technology. It is also a technology of how we create knowledge, because our present agriculture
has become a lot poorer, mainly because it is dominated by person. Decisions are dominated by people who have never farmed, even though they are farm officers. Most of the people who are agricultural officers have never maintained 1 acre land for their own family. They have graduated with the agriculture somehow. So about trees, many times they have no knowledge. In horticulture, for example, in dry area in West Bengal, they were talking about giving men mango seedling. I said, why not falsa, which is Gravia aseptica. It fruits in 3 years. It can easily started from seed, and it has very, very much more nutrition compared to mango. Is only one season. So this official, he was asking me, but you see, this was about 10 years ago, that mango is more expensive in the market. How much money one can earn by selling falsa? So I asked, do you know falsa? So he will not say that I don't know. So as all Indian officials, they are not supposed to say we don't know. So he said, how much money? It is a small fruit. I said, yes, it is a small fruit. But mango at that time was 20 rupees a kilo for farmer selling, not in the market. Now it is maybe more, much more. So I explained the falsa is 100 rupees a kilo. So if it is mango is 20, this is 100. So it is a 5-10 difference. So why not encourage people to grow those trees which are nutritious and which are drought tolerant and which people can grow easily from seed? Why grafting and all this? What is the essential thing on that? So sometimes we take for granted that knowledge always flows from top to bottom. So it is also important that bottom to top happens, and bottom to bottom and top to top also happens. That, so there are 4 ways of knowledge flowing. Top to top, between official, between farmers, farmers to officials, and officials to farmers. One of our main difficulties is that even I worked for about 3 years as a instructor, assistant to a, I had no agriculture degree, but I was rural development, and I had students in Allahabad Agriculture Institute, Naini, because the Japanese farmer who officially was supposed to teach, he got hepatitis and went back, so he handed over the farm to me and said that you produce, anyway you can do experiment and you can produce food for yourselves. There were about 15 students and we had to. And so because I did not know much about, that was fortunate, about vegetables, so I grew 50-60 varieties of vegetables to check which one will grow and which one. The other teachers were from Australia and Germany and Japan, three. Therefore, we had a lot of exchange and lot of experiments and see. But later on, I had two, three kinds of problems. One is that somebody started the rumor that he is a Brahmin. Why is he entering the field and doing ploughing himself or something? This is not a good example. The second problem was that this is a agricultural area. Why you are planting trees here? Horticulture is there. So if you want to grow horticulture, if you want to grow a tree, you should get horticultural land. And when I go to horticulture, they say, why you are growing rice here? It is supposed to be grown in the other field. So in India, we have created all this. We have, like in health, we have nose specialist, ear specialist, throat specialist, everything. There is no human specialist. So if you want to, no more, the general physician is missing now. So if you want to talk about agriculture, the farmer has to deal with all. He has 2 goats, she has 3 pigs, also some crop, also some tree. So very often specialization is not the answer, integration is the answer. Next.
Yeah, so this is showing again how people use making litter, how we can learn from that. Next. So animals are very important part of poor people life. This is not wetland photograph, this is from a dry land in Bakuda district. So goats and things. The important thing to show next is that now the officials in the block have understood our point that if more than half of the village is depending on the local domestic animals, why you have no loan, no teaching, no, is there not a scientific way to keep this? Is it a really such a way? So now they are coming and sitting with the women and teaching them how to inject the local breed and all things. This is happening in some areas. So it is not, there are many hopeless situations. We are often overwhelmed by that, but it is also important to keep on dialogue with the institution and try to change the attitude towards poor people. Because more than half of the people, almost in any area in India, they are landless. And they work in somebody else's land or borrow the land or work as agricultural laborer. This is important to understand. So permaculture actually have to extend not only to agricultural land but also to forest, also to roadside, also to other, because these are the capital for the landless people. So this idea that one person will have 5 acres of land, then in whole Sundarban you will not find a single person. Maybe you will get 10 people together to work in a group, each person having 1 acre, so together a 10-acre plot, we can plant trees, things. So work in a group is important. Next. Saving the seeds is important. I already said before why. And so this is the jackbean. So many kind of seed. This is an individual collection. This man is proud. This is a group collection. So keeping in mud pots and keeping sometime the whole fruit for planting. So it's a group seed bag. Yeah, next.
How do you cover the mud pot?
How do you seal the mud pot? How do we seal? With a little bit of a tap and some nail bit and sometimes a little bit of cow dung and thing. But before putting the seed, once you are taking the seed from the field, you need to dry them for at least 2-3 weeks in an aerated surface. Maybe hang some baskets and put something so that air is always, this is important. Yeah, so this is rice bank, another example of a non-monetary exchange between people. Permaculture also stresses very much on that. So before they were borrowing from rich people and have to pay exorbitant interest, now they keep rice in this, they make the rope with which they make a basket and keep the rice inside that. And they can borrow in paddy and return in paddy. No money is involved. And initially we give some, only thing we have done is make it a little high so that rats cannot enter. So that cement platform we have contributed some money. And the other, we have given some initial loan which is paid back from second year by one third and given to another community. And so by that time it becomes their own. For about 10 families, 18 families only. Next, because there is no time. So, last idea that in all situations there will be some stress period. There will be some time, too much rain or too little rain. Just like we store food above the in the grain storage, there are many plants like this is elephant food. And next one. So they are called strategic crops. Why? Because they are a strategy to deal with food shortages in short time. And they are different. This leaf is a vegetable. But the root, without cold storage, without anything, can be stored for 5-6 months. And if there is no crisis, you can leave it behind in the soil. And next year it will become bigger. So all tubers tubers have starch, so they are replacement for rice, they are replacement for wheat. They are not just vegetables. So sweet potato, yam, all kinds, they can be very important to have a 3 meter by 3 meter plot and grow them in the house and try to make that next finish. Yeah, so this training is very important. Here again, a girl is learning how to breed a calf or something and learning circle garden next. So learning about SRI method of system of weed control and other kind of thing. Next. So training people, especially young men, women, because they have not got the opportunity. It is important to do trainings for people who have maybe passed class 7-8 and have no plans to go to any city or other thing. They need to learn more about fish and duck and other things so that they can do scientific kind of agriculture in their community and lead that process next. So, and selling those products also is important. That is, so this is, I will not explain because there is no time to explain. Next, umbrella and other thing. This multi-use trees where you can eat the fruit, eat the leaf, jackfruit where you can eat either fruit as a vegetable, use the wood as for making doors and things. So these are important. Next, drumstick, when there is all stick and all the, that is new also there. Next, this is again reminding that small farmers, small who keep chicken, who keep grow many kind of vegetables, they are our future and we have to work with them. Next is maybe the fence. And that is our website.